Okay, good morning, everybody. Friday morning crowd at RSA is always a good one, so thanks for sticking it out and thanks for coming. Let's get going with this. Is anybody up for audience participation? Because I'd just like to get a short file of who in here is a user of crypto APIs, who in here is a producer of APIs, and who in here doesn't do code at all and is just kind of interested. Last one. Most people. Okay, good. Then I will use that set of notes. Excellent. So a lot of us in this room will probably know about the Johnny can't encrypt comment. I don't know how many people know where it came from, and there's a smaller number of people who actually know what was in it. But back in 1999, Alma Witten and J.D. Tugger wrote this quite insightful paper at the time, looking at why people got PGP encryption wrong. You know, there's this version 5, pretty mature industry even by then, and yet still there was a lot of stuff that people just couldn't do. They couldn't get the results they wanted. They couldn't get the kind of information security that they wanted from the best available tool at the time. So they went through a little bit of a usability study, explicitly trying to argue that the way that you build computer programs and the way that you build security APIs and crypto APIs cannot be the same. The way you present them to users cannot be the same because they're very different. And the reason why we were failing was because we were trying to apply basic concepts to a very unbasic situation. And so they did this study back in 1999 and found some pretty insightful results and published them, and we all thought that that was going to make things better, except it didn't, because back in 06 we discovered that it wasn't a whole lot better. But, you know, lest we forget, the world moves on, and in 2012 it wasn't a whole lot better with Facebook, and last year it wasn't that much better with the current version of PGP. In fact, what we've discovered through all of these studies that have been done, all on the same lines, all with very similar aims, and all with very similar results, in fact, is that even though Johnny is now 18, and you may tell from my accent that in my country that means he can drink in bars, he still can't encrypt. So why not? Well, the interesting thing is that in all the 18 years and all of the development and all of the many different techniques we've tried and programs we've had and huge amount more interest in the industry. I mean, I spoke here in 2009, and I think the attendance was something like 18,000 people. This year, I think they're forecasting something like 45,000. Quick check from the organizer. Yeah, so you know, huge growth in the industry, and it's still not really making things a whole lot better. These things up here are the kind of key findings from the original 99 paper, and they're repeated over and over and over again. Now, interestingly, almost all of these things are blaming the user in one way or another. The user is either wrong, they're uneducated, they're making mistakes, they're having accidents, or maybe they're just lazy in some way. Manual key signing is a pain. Nobody wants to go to PGP key signing ceremonies anymore. So I see one person who does, but most people don't want to do that. So you know, in the original Alma Witten paper, the number one identified potential hurdle to security usability and the way that people engage with security or encryption APIs was the idea that the user simply doesn't want to. It's the unmotivated user problem. It's a well-documented issue in protocol design. So you might be forgiven for thinking that Johnny just doesn't want to encrypt then. He is the unmotivated user made flesh, except he isn't, because as we've seen with this growth of the RSA show, we also see a growth in the industry. And a growth in interest at large in people wanting to encrypt. So, nice abstract graph for you. But we, at Thales, we do surveys every year of not creators and not necessarily scientists, but last year, over 5,000 IT professionals, people in serious risk, key management type jobs, and also people in lines of business where security is important, so lots of finance, big major IT manufacturing, industrial type folks. And sure, in 2005, people weren't that interested. It wasn't a high priority, but now it is. So the idea that Johnny is unmotivated, I think, is no longer founded. But if he does want to, he definitely still can't. By the evidence we see of breaches, of poor implementations, of lack of encryption, of continuing all of those mistakes that have been identified and indeed predicted every time we do a study of this kind, there's something wrong with what we're doing that just makes it too tough for him to go ahead. So why can't he? There's a growing feeling, or maybe not a growing feeling, but a growing recognition that maybe it's our fault as industry that we're doing something wrong. Same as the original premise from 1999, maybe we're just trying to go about things the wrong way, trying to present things in a way that just doesn't fit what the user's trying to do. And I take this blame on myself here, because you know, I've worked in plenty of standards bodies, I've written plenty of things that are completely anathema to what I'm going to suggest that we do later on. But you know, the industry as a whole, I think, might be going about things the wrong way. And when we look back at some more of the studies that we did, this is, I think, proven out by this. No matter how many times we try to evolve things, no matter how many vendors there are on the show floors selling new and innovative things and stuff that's going to make your life better, mistakes, human error, a need for training is identified constantly as what's going wrong. And even the experts are starting to say that now, right? So this chap is extremely skilled, I would say, and versed in cryptography. You couldn't take that away from him, but even he is giving up on how this works. It's just not been possible to get a sort of long-term feeling of safety to do what you actually wanted to do, which was to communicate with all the properties of email, but without all of the properties of email that mean you lose your stuff into the wrong hands. So the industry, I think, is starting to recognize that we're doing things wrong and we need to change, but how do we want to change? Now, note, I did advertise this was going to be about APIs, and I've been complaining about PGP. No offense to any of my friends in the audience who worked on PGP. I love you all. But it's a good example, right? And the issue with the example is that now that Johnny is 18, of course, he likes to drink in bars, and if Johnny likes to drink in bars, he needs to pay for that, so he needs a job. So Johnny is now a programmer, and security APIs are kind of the new email encryption. It's necessary these days for people to get to grips with that. You can't be a programmer anymore if you don't also have some appreciation of security. The question is that appreciation of security going to line up with what we as the long-term crypto and security guys have created as the foundation for you? So back to basics quickly, because in the PGP case, in the Johnny case, all you were trying to do, and there is a sort of gold standard hypothesis even in the paper if you care to read it, but all that Johnny was trying to do was to communicate with the people with whom he wanted to communicate without having the things intercepted, read by the wrong people. And this contributes to a very common feeling, especially in non-specialist programmers and program designers. This contributes to a feeling that crypto is all about keeping secrets. It's very often the case that if you see a standard billboard advert for something, you'll have usually a lady, lamentably, that's how we live. You'll have a picture of a person with a finger over their mouth. They're trying to keep a secret, they're trying to keep quiet. But that's actually not really what we're trying to do. All we're trying to do is much closer to can you keep your promises rather than keep a secret. It's much more subtle than it seemed. Because security ultimately is nothing more than trying to make stuff work properly. If your stuff works properly all of the time, then you have a completely secure system. That's it. And it's only when you start to load in contrary events, such as attacks or data breaches or solar flares or whatever might be interesting to you, but it's only when you add some other function that will make the thing fail that you need to fix that. And sometimes that's going to be a reliability, robustness, a physical thing to fix, and sometimes it's going to be a logical thing which you can fix with crypto. But really what we're trying to do when we present crypto APIs and toolkits and devices to application makers, we're trying to make their things work. Very simple point in case. I would argue, and I am a vendor, but I would argue that nobody needs security to begin with. What they need is to go about their life. And when they discover that their life is somehow threatened or interrupted, then they need the security to make that work. So keeping your promises, keeping reliability going, making stuff work properly, that's what we're trying to do. But as we went through the research, of course, we had the keeping secret thing, so we developed lots of clever maths for encryption and stuff like that, and then had lots of things going on to improve that. And when we got into the keeping your promises, we got into digital signatures, and we started to sort of have certificates and PKIs, and we developed lots and lots of stuff to do that. And partly, or maybe even largely, because of the types of people who were looking at this and because of the hardness of the fundamental problem, we turned this into this. Now most of us, I guess anyone here who's a researcher, anyone here who works with academia or has a sort of dynamic product set going on, there's a serious race in the industry, as we all know, where you invent something, then it gets broken, then you improve it, then there's a sort of improve, break cycle that goes on as we fix things. And something that's been exciting to me, as I've worked in a lot of standards bodies and built you know, proprietary and open standards and APIs, and then been slightly outside the industry for a while and been a user of the same things, is that what we did was we didn't take these concepts and improve them in the dimension that people wanted. We found a simple answer in the form of these things and then started to grow those instead. So let's take a look at a very popular, in one sense, API, PKSys11. PKSys11, all you wanted to do, dear Johnny, was encrypt. And yet, in order to do that, you have to do some stuff. Well, okay, if you're a programmer, then suck it up. You have to do some kind of housekeeping. That's just how programs work. But then, very quickly, you're forced to choose a mechanism to do your encryption. So all I wanted to do was to send a thing to my buddy and have only my buddy read it. But actually what I have to do is to choose a mechanism. I don't even know what that means because I'm just a random programmer. But luckily I know where to go to find out. I can go to the PKSys11 reference, which now thankfully is part of Oasis, even, you know, easier to access even than it was before. So I can go onto the Oasis website. I can download this lovely document here. So then all I need to do is pick an option, right? After I've read 201 pages, then I can pick an option for that one parameter. And that's before I've worked out which key I want to use, because all of our crypto APIs, for some reason, still insist on putting the actual key in. And so now, after I've read the 201 pages for that, because I was presented it in that order, so of course that's the way I'm doing my research, now I come down to here, and now I have to choose what type of key it is, and I have to put all of these parameters in, and I have to work out everything that's going on. And these are handed to me because the key already existed. So then I have to go back and think whether that's actually an appropriate choice, because that changed it for me. Right? All of this stuff makes perfect sense if you approach it from the very pure crypto point of view, because crypto absolutely fails if you don't get all of the details right and all the details coherent. And this is recognized in all the usability papers too. I think it's number 4. In the 5 hurdles to security in the 99 paper. So absolutely all this stuff needs to be known, but why on earth have we subjected so many non-specialist programmers in the past to making these decisions and reading this much stuff and then probably getting it wrong? It's amazing. We do sometimes try to make life easier for people, and I don't expect you to read this, it's too small even for me here, but there's an interesting kind of get out in all programming, crypto, not at all special in this regard, where if you give somebody a manual and you kind of tell them a little bit about something, then you can claim that they're informed and you can wash your hands of what's going on. But in this this particular case with the JCA implementation, very popular, people using Java will often do this, and they might just do it by accident because it's sort of dragged along by default, it's part of some other set of assemblies or whatever. you've got in there three lines plus a footnote that try to describe the difference between symmetric and asymmetric cryptography. That's not enough. But it is enough that somebody coming at this who doesn't really care too much about it because they're just trying to get their job done and they've been told to encrypt something, or there's some mandate in their programming standards now that you always do things, it's enough that they'll probably think they're okay because they've been told. They've read a thing, they've made a choice. This is actually more dangerous than telling them nothing at all, because this is where inappropriate choices of everything comes from. So you've actually made people's lives worse by doing this. And what's interesting about these crypto APIs is that an awful lot of the things that are wrong with the APIs is exactly the same stuff that was wrong with the usability interfaces and with your encrypting mail clients and stuff like that. You know, the user's expected to make critical choices, and they're uninformed. And it's not a bad thing for the user to be uninformed, because I suspect not many of us are that great at putting together riveting plans for tailplanes on high-speed planes. Right? People have specialities. That are all different, and we shouldn't expect a standard programmer to understand how to make these choices. You make irreversible decisions early. Key management, still manual. Trust establishment, still very manual. And you've got sort of far too many details to choose from where you have to sort of make a choice. You get confused and you can make all kinds of mistakes. But there's not enough detail necessarily to actually apply the kind of protection that you wanted. I'll come back to in a second. Because policy decisions, when you are crypto first, are made too early. Effectively, what happens, the very second you've encrypted something, you've decided how it can be decrypted again. Now, when I encrypt something, what I'm trying to do as a user or as a system builder, what I'm trying to do is to determine when it will be brought back again. But what I've actually done is to commit all of those choices right at the very beginning. So imagine that what I'm actually trying to say is, I want to encrypt my results for my small company, and I want to send them out to the board of directors for preview reading, that kind of intention. Well, turning that immediately into a symmetric key is probably not the very best way of coping with things like a changing composition of the board of directors, or with the way that I interact with them, the way that I get them the key, and that kind of thing. Because it actually makes you really insecure. What you wanted to do was to wait until the point of decryption, apply the policy check, recheck that the intent is allowed, and then do the thing. But actually what you've done is, on day one, as soon as you encrypted it, you've left all of that future state, all of that dynamism, all of that potential for change and fluidity in the world, you've left that to the secrecy of many copies of an already disseminated symmetric key. It doesn't make a lot of sense. It makes them very insecure. Julian Clulow and Graham Steele and his friends did a lot of work a little while ago, and Graham even now has a company doing this kind of thing as a sort of full-on consultancy, because it's still so prolific. They did a lot of work on analyzing PKSys 11 both as a standard and as implementations, and found that because of the way that all of the options interact, even in some cases where you've done things perfectly independently, you can have situations where you use a sequence of calls that get plain text keys out. So if anything a PKSys 11 token is supposed to do, it's supposed to keep the key inside it and not let you steal it away. But because of the complexity of the thing and because of the lack of application of a real security policy, but it just being effectively a bag of bits, they found a number of very cunning ways to pull keys out of PKSys11 tokens. Thankfully, not from the PKSys11 implementation that we were shipping in my company at the time, because we did it a different way. But lots of problems with that. Even away from the complex world of P11 and all of the many options and all the mistakes you can make and all of the combinatorial issues that it has, some very simple stuff like this one. I won't mention the name of the company or the name of the hack that this is associated with, but I think several of us know. You know, there are very serious issues with certain aspects of key management, key creation, policy application, and it's kind of exciting when you can hack a physical hardware device simply by cryptanalyzing perfectly legitimate and perfectly secure in their own right payloads. So making decisions like the one we saw on the P11 thing a little while ago, where you've created a key from a bunch of decisions, that people didn't understand, you end up with actually just a house of cards, and a single thing makes you fall over. The generic backstory to this, by the way, is simply that if you don't create your crypto keys properly, you sometimes lose. So, recognizing that, we decided as an industry around the sort of 06-ish mark, I suppose, we decided to invent a new problem for people to have, to cover up the old problem, maybe just to take their minds off it. You know, if you've ever been in hospital, I hope you haven't, but just in case, if anyone's ever been in hospital with like a broken arm or something, you get the Entonox, the gas and air thing. Entonox isn't actually a painkiller, it doesn't take the pain away, but it kind of distracts you and makes you think about something else. I consider a lot of these systems to be kind of like that. The pain's still there, the problems are still there, but you're distracted and you can think of something else. So this is a popular representation of how key lifecycle management works. It's effectively the submission copy from IEEE a little while ago that we were working on for storage encryption. So simple enough use case, but you still need to be able to turn your keys over and things. So a bunch of experts came together and put together this really simple model for how keys should work, only it's not really as simple as it looks. When you go to the users of these systems, and the technology and the products that came out of the standards group that was building this model, by the way, is well in use now across all big industries, banks, finance, everything else, we surveyed those same people to see how they were getting on and how it's working. And we didn't even need to ask them if managing keys was painful. You can start there, we know that's true. So what makes managing keys so painful? Well, once again, it's the stupid user problem, right? We've got this this issue where we've got no skilled personnel. People just can't do it. Johnny can't manage his encrypting tape array. Well, that's stupid Johnny. He's had time to learn, right? But, well, actually, not too far behind, we're saying that the tools are inadequate. So it's no good blaming Johnny if he hasn't got tools that he can use. And you have to wonder if the reason that Johnny can't do it is because his tools are inadequate, and the tools are inadequate because nobody really owns the problem, because nobody knows what they're doing, and nobody can apply the really abstract key management thing, which came from a really, really abstract encryption and crypto thing. Nobody knows how to apply it to a real use case. So what did we do that was wrong in the key management space? And this is KMIP. I picked it because I was an original founder of KMIP, so I reckon that I'm allowed to sort of say slightly bad things about it without without seeming too awful. But we came together in 2008. There's only four of us at the time. Came together thinking that it would be a great idea to have a standard for key management, to make it easy for people to never have the problems that we just discovered we already did still have last year. It's very Marty McFly, but we came together, leading people, Encypher at the time, leading HSMs, PKIs, there was EMC, RSA even involved. We came together to make a simple key management interoperability standard. And yet, very, very rapidly, we came up with concepts like the cryptographic usage mask. And when I say I picked KMIP because I worked on it and I can be rude about it, I picked this page because I wrote this page and I can definitely be rude about this. We discovered very quickly a need, because we were managing old crypto systems that had grown up the way they'd grown up, that we had to accommodate all of the weird, strange options that nobody understands, that nobody can really pick, and that if you use them in a funny combination, are desperately insecure. And so in the first version of the standard that was supposed to take all the pain away and make the world easy, we had the cryptographic usage mask which starts off with the already troubling but lamentably necessary concept of applying asymmetric crypto techniques to symmetric keys. So, you know, very basic example, retail max, something like that. You have to give both sides all of the key material, you give them all of the power, you completely break any technical fundament to the security of the system, and then you overlay a thing where you ask it really nicely if it wouldn't mind playing by the rules, just so that your protocol still works, please. And what's more worrying about this particular example is that it's only one out of 44 choices you have to make when you generate your key in this system. It's insane. We've never, ever managed to come up with a way of divesting the legacy of turning what was a fairly simple real-world problem into a very complex math problem. And it's absolutely, absolutely right in the crypto layer that we should have all of these options and all of these choices. Side-channel attacks are a real thing, and that's very serious. Appropriate choices of ciphers and mechanisms are desperately important. If you're going to be streaming media at high-speed multicast, you do need different math to support that properly compared with downloading a document onto a single secure file server, that kind of thing. All of these options are necessary, and all of the math work we do and all of those small improvements in cryptanalysis and everything, absolutely fundamentally vital to what we do. But it's at the wrong level, because what we've ended up doing is giving every single user one of these to fly when, you know, most human beings only just managed to drive one of those. Because we've loaded all of the complexity into the wrong place. As I mentioned, my preferred method of encryption is to delete stuff. Because unless you wanted it back, then why would you store it? Why would you waste the space? Why would you kill so many trees burning up the electricity to store something that you never, ever wanted again? So you know, this is the best the encryption API you can get. As soon as you've decided not to do that, then actually, what you're really going for, again, as I said earlier, is a predicting your decrypt API. But again, we put all of this complexity and all of this cipher stuff and all of these choices and whatever, all of it goes on the encrypt case and none of it goes on the decrypt case. So coming back to this, making choices so early on when I had my secured, my sensitive data and I had to make a choice, shall I delete it or shall I store it so that at some point in the future, under some circumstances, when some set of people or machines want to get it back, I'll let them have it back. And we make people make that choice and define exactly who's going to have that symmetric key and exactly how they're going to access it and what systems they're going to access it on and whether those systems will play by the rules nicely or not, who those people are, the full extent of what will happen, and implicitly, whether or not my semantic problem of I only want the board to see my pre-release results is actually represented by the technology. You load all of that on the encrypt choice in a single parameter where you can't see, and none of it is then applied on the decrypt case at the point of use, at the point where you can actually now make a contextual real decision about whether your needs are being met. And we've got so many other issues. We've got key rotation stuff, people changing, databases, lifetimes, all of this stuff. I mean, if you recognize these, then you'll know what I mean. If you don't, then you know, don't worry about it. It's just the world is a worse place than you thought. Sorry about that. But you know, one of them is that crypto is just complicated. Like I keep saying, I'm not saying crypto is bad. I'm not saying we shouldn't do math. I'm not saying we shouldn't have cryptanalysis and side-channel analysis and all that sort of stuff. It's really important, right? I trust math. Math is truth. So that's okay. But it's not for everybody. Crypto is really complicated. And what we've tried to do, as we discovered over many years, was to explain it to people. Because if you explain something, then it definitely gets easy. So we came up with these metaphors for encryption and signing and whatever. And we have the key and we have the locks, and we have channels and everything else. And this is great because it makes people feel like they understand. But actually, as soon as you get into any level of detail, these metaphors really fail us. They fall down very rapidly if you get further and further away from the industry. And the thing that that we need to be really mindful of is that from that first graph I showed you, where people didn't usually care that much about encryption, but we've now completely flipped and people really do care about encryption, the problem is you need to get your explanations better, or you need to stop using them, because the further people get from a skilled position, the more dangerous it is for them to think they understand, and the more these things fall down. So really what we want to do, as we move into this world which in which we simply cannot rely on expert users. And Johnny really is just a grad student participating in a small user study back in 1999. What you're really looking at is data security and policy. Back when crypto was a research topic, well, it still is a research topic, but back when it was really a research topic, and we came up with the encrypt decrypt sign verify hash stuff, that was perfectly right and reasonable, and you could play with toolkits and you could put things together and you could prove that the points work, and if everybody was perfectly happy to play by the rules and perfectly understood everything, and there weren't too many of you, which is the big problem with long-term life cycles and PGP key management, then that was okay. But now, as more and more people get interested in using this, we need to mature it and we need to be really clean about abstracting away what we're really trying to do. And we're not trying to do crypto. We're just trying to apply some kind of security policy around sensitive data. And at the same time as people have decided crypto is a good idea, more people have decided that they don't care whether it's a good idea or not, but they have some government mandate, some standard to meet, some set of audit requirements to hit, and crypto helps. Also true, also great, but you gotta help them think about it in a different way. This is all now about data security and policy application. We just split that out. So let's make those APIs, and let's recharge the battery on this when you have time. Especially in the modern world, all of those many things that I mentioned on the other slide about databases, key rotation, changes of custodian, all of these dynamic considerations, the way that applications work today, the way that the API economy works, the way that big data changes all the time. You cut the data one way, then security works one way. If you cut the data another way, it's completely changed. Especially when you get into privacy use cases and things like that, and mandated anonymization, all those kinds of things. The data is exactly the same, it's stored in exactly the same place, but if you have an analysis engine come in and look at it in a particular way, your whole use case blows up. So the idea that you can apply to any kind of modern context the old ideas of predefining, preordaining the details of a particular key at some point in time, static and fixed, simply doesn't apply anymore. And what we can do instead is to give people APIs and UIs. And rightly, APIs and UIs are kind of the same thing these days, which I like. A number of us are well-versed in RESTful stuff. We give people APIs that actually talk about what they're trying to do. So if you have somebody's health record, I don't want anybody to get that health record until these conditions are met. Sounds obvious, it probably sounds like loads of the things you can see downstairs, but the point is, an awful lot of products that we see built up around the industry, including PGP interfaces, are still based on the same fundamental primitives. So you have an illusion of having protection, you have an illusion of usability and user-friendliness, you have some illusion of being connected to the use case you're trying to do, but actually it very quickly resolves into something that isn't. And what we actually need to do, and what we are doing in many cases, is actually applying directly the security policy evaluations to the data and to the use case and to the business that is operating. This isn't just a crypto question at this point. I think the thing that's really proving difficult for a number of people to, or a number of bodies, I should say, to come to terms with, is that we can only solve real problems in the real world now if we have a systemic approach to full data security. And that means some crypto, but also things like secure execution environments, things like, you know, looking after how the machine works is just as important as looking after the crypto and looking after the messages on the wire. You know, if you go back to that cryptographic usage mask, if you have a key and one person promises they're only ever going to encrypt stuff because they're the sales clerk and they're getting orders in and credit cards and stuff, and they're going to push things into the encrypted database, but they promise they'll never get them out again. So they only have encrypt. And the other guy only has decrypt because, you know, they didn't read the manual properly, and so encrypting a record makes it true. So they don't want to get this guy to be able to insert fake records, but they need to read them off, audit them, you know, process them, whatever. You need to make sure that whatever environment, whatever machine, whether it's an HSM, whether it's an embedded technology or something else, you need to make sure that it's actually operating exactly as it's supposed to operate. And both sides of the equation need to be able to verify that it can do that. And everybody else needs to understand how to interoperate with it, because the world has moved on from a simple, simply keeping key safe doesn't help you. Now you have to keep the access control on the key safe. Well, that's great, but now you have to keep the semantic policy on the key safe. So we absolutely can build data security APIs that are better, that do help Johnny to encrypt. But at the same time, we need to be also building and standardizing how we do secure execution, how we do trusted execution, and how we have integrity on these really rich policies that people really wanted to implement. So, things to consider. So this is why I asked for the show of hands at the beginning, because, you know, this is not a solo game, and I wanted to know how many people were actually developing crypto APIs, who was using, so on. Because the considerations that we're looking at, and where I'm hoping to get to, especially with folks who are vendors here or folks who are developing, researching, whatever, is to come back to the real problem we were trying to solve. The problem we were trying to solve was not crypto, and it wasn't key management. And the meta problems we have behind that is stuff like this. Security is contextual and dynamic and sometimes subjective, especially with privacy being so important these days. Sometimes I will want someone to see my stuff, and sometimes I won't. And it's not at all possible to commit that kind of indecision, which is dependent on future context. It's not possible to put that into a direct relationship with a secret or with a piece of math. So we need to actually define into our APIs, into our protocols, and into known secure execution properties that kind of dynamic context. Because just because we can't do it, just because it's hard, doesn't make it not true. And variously, this leads to inhibition in people using crypto because it doesn't fit their needs, or it leads to people doing it wrong because, well, that's what happens. Now, as I say, the clever corners are always necessary. I love the guys who do the cryptanalysis and who find clever tweaks and who can take a bit off the effective strength of something. It's awesome. But not everybody needs to see that all the time. And so being able to apply a sensible filter to things, not presenting that kind of stuff to the wrong layer, that's really important. And it's really tempting, especially when you're building something on top of P11 or something, it's really tempting to just punt that choice and say, hey, let the user choose. We shouldn't do that. We should take more responsibility for working out good, complete systems where those choices don't need to be taken by individual users because we've decided globally on a decent set of sets that works for them. Clearly, breakthroughs in cryptanalysis. If ordinary companies have to worry about checking what algorithms they're using all the time when stuff happens, this is not a sustainable system. So again, layering is really important. We should absolutely be able to recover everybody if something happens, but that should be a small exercise by experts under the covers. It shouldn't be something that hits the surface. Nice quote by M.N. Plano, don't assign to stupidity what might be due to ignorance. And try not to assume your opponent is the ignorant one until you show it isn't you. I think there's it's a lesson for any technical industry, but a good one for us too. You know, constantly blaming Johnny for mistakes and accidents, that hasn't got us anywhere, so let's not keep that going. And understand the value of the data, because the perfect is the enemy of the good, as they say. Sometimes we even take things too far. We give these options to users because we want to give somebody a choice to say, if you really, really want to, you can be 521-bit ECC and you can use it. Or if you're a really shonky, don't care user, you can choose this other. They don't want that choice. It doesn't matter. We should be able to come up with ways of giving them appropriate levels of security, probably the hardest, but not necessarily. It's a trade-off, without them having to make that choice. And that depends on the value of the data. It doesn't depend on the programmer behind the keyboard. It doesn't depend on the program. It's the data running through it. So don't give the programmer that kind of choice. So, we can take all of those things, out with what I've said. So what to do next? If you are a user of crypto API, so this is a really interesting thing. As a vendor for quite a long time, but also as a customer, I've been on board of directors on standards bodies and TCs and things like that. I've seen a lot of input from industry saying we need security and so on. They very quickly come and ask half understanding technical crypto questions. You don't need to do that if you're a user. If you're here representing a programming team in a bank or something, don't try to translate into crypto speak too early, because then us guys on the crypto side will get very lazy and happy and just give you what you asked for, but it probably isn't what you wanted. So absolutely explain what the use case is. As a developer, kind of remember the opposite. The end goal is not crypto. Crypto is like a seventh derived need that people have, which comes from the ultimate first need of, I need food, I need to buy food, I need a job, I need to write a program. That's where stuff comes from. Crypto is a long way down on the actual priority list. Again, I love it. That's why I work in this industry. It's great and it's really powerful and it's a very serious part of the arsenal in protecting information security, but you've got to remember to use it in the right way. And join standards organizations. I know it's slow, I know it's difficult, but the more of us there are, the better. And do participate, don't just join, okay? So, that's it, thank you very much. And I hope if you are a vendor or a developer of crypto APIs that we can all collectively do better in the future.